that's the question that you can maybe come back to later, but let's hear.
Yeah, I don't think, first of all, thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure for me to be back here after a year or so. I don't think the trade-off between the two is as steep as it used to be, but let me start by taking an overview of the state of capital markets globally. So 2020 has witnessed a record debt issuance, maybe the highest since 2008, across the world. And debt has increased substantially in the European Union by somewhere in the territory of 15 to 20%. It has gone up in the United States and Japan by somewhere between 25 and 30%. And interestingly, same goes for many emerging markets and developing economies. Typically, capital markets cannot be used as a buffer in times of crisis in emerging markets and developing economies. We are all familiar with the cycle of capital markets shutting, capital inflows reversing, and then therefore capital outflows, sudden stops, forcing emerging market economies and developing economies to pursue pro-cyclical policies in times of crisis. But this time around, I think they acted as a shock absorber in an unusual fashion, and therefore it enabled even emerging market economies and developing economies to pursue counter-cyclical policies. So a key question to ask, and a question that I keep asking myself, is why are markets so relaxed this time around? Is it that debt sustainability is no longer on top of minds as far as capital markets go? And I think the answer is pretty straightforward. As far as Europe goes, the key was the quick and decisive action on the part of the European Central Bank with the pandemic emergency purchasing program, Mark 1 and Mark 2, and of course, later on, the coordination between fiscal and monetary policies in Europe with the fleshing out of the recovery and resilience stand of the European Union. And at global level, I think the Fed played a very important role, both in lowering interest rates as well as extending currency swap lines to emerging market economies. So all in all, monetary policy action was key, and policy coordination overall was key to calm market sentiment and convey the message that what economists would call R minus G, that is the difference between the nominal interest rate on one hand and the nominal growth rate of output on the other, the driver, if you like, the automatic driver of debt sustainability will remain negative for the years to come. And of course, a negative R minus G allowed for at least some room for fiscal stimulus. Now, there is plenty of heterogeneity in the way countries responded to the degree to which they responded, if you like, to the COVID-19 crisis. Some countries responded much more aggressively than others. I think Greece is on the lower bound of the extent to which it pursued discretionary fiscal stimulus, but overall the reaction across the globe was good. Does this mean that markets might shift it in a fundamental way, a way of debt sustainability questions, or are we expecting to see again sustainability concerns re-emerging? And my key message here is that we shouldn't derive too much comfort from the way markets have responded. So far, it's not unlikely that fragility can resurface, especially in the emerging market economies and as far as Europe goes, in the periphery of Europe, to those countries that were most affected by the COVID-19 crisis, and Greece is one of them. Does this mean that we are back exactly to the question you put on a steep trade-off between sustainability and recovery? Do policymakers, do authorities have again to choose between accommodating a sustained economic recovery on one hand and taking care of sustainability on the other? to my mind, this trade-off is not as steep as it used to be. And the key risk, the immediate key risk to debt sustainability at this point is a weak and fragile economic recovery, not just in the short term. I'm not talking about the quarter-on-quarter growth rates. I'm talking more about the negative impact of COVID-19 and the lack of policy initiative may have on potential growth. And therefore, the trend growth rate of an economy is especially great. So how do we tread this fine line of keeping capital markets calm, containing, if you like, sustainability concerns on one hand, and stimulating economic recovery on the other? I think at this stage, and given that the COVID-19 crisis is still unfolding, we should keep in mind six key takeaways. First of all, there should be no premature exit from the accommodative fiscal stance. We don't yet know when the COVID-19 crisis will be over, but we know that any premature exit of fiscal stimulus will have seriously damaging effects on not just on short-term, but also on potential growth through the impact on human capital, long-term unemployment, but also physical capital, private sector indebtedness, and so on. Point number two, keep spending, but keep spending, and maybe keep spending aggressively, but keep spending wisely with emphasis on targeted measures that can have an impact on long-term or potential growth. And of course, the Recovery and Resilience Fund here will play a key role, but beyond this, I think the government should pursue a targeted policy of supporting those sectors that have been most affected by the COVID-19 crisis. It's been a global crisis, but in many ways it's been a sector-specific crisis. And as the economy recovers, there are sectors, especially in Greece, that will need significant support. And this support can take, I'm just giving an example, I think it's the best targeted tool, can take the form of subsidizing employment, subsidizing wages. Point number three, there should be a way to deal with effectively private sector indebtedness. There is no question that the private sector, especially in Greece, will emerge from the crisis seriously affected, heavily indebted, and therefore even viable firms that can if you like, produce a social good, not just a private good, but a social good for the Greek economy, may end up going bankrupt unless there is a clever mechanism, a clever device to deal with private sector indebtedness. Point number four, turning now my attention to Europe, I think PEP, the Pandemic Emergency Purchase Program, has to be extended for the years to come. And I think this should be a clear signal sent out to markets as early as now. It will be very important at the time of accommodative fiscal policy, markets know that there will be a buyer there, a buyer of last resort if needed, to maintain interest rates low. Point number five, we all know that at some point a fiscal rule will have to return. It has to return. Fiscal policy should be coordinated at European level. We don't know the exact characteristics of this rule yet, but we of course know that there shouldn't be a free-for-all forever. We shouldn't, however, rush to introduce again a rule with an austerity bias built into it. So we have to be very careful and use the crisis as an opportunity to design a clever mechanism that will allow a gradual return to fiscal discipline. Again, it may take several years before we reach that point. And finally, a key takeaway message for the authorities, I think, it's not time to think in a business as usual modality. I think it's time to be bold and be aggressive and be ambitious also in the way they handle both protection as well as reallocation issues of the economy. Maybe I should stop here.